kills y'all. It's the dollar dollar bill, y'all. It's the dollar dollar bill. It's the dollar bill that kills. Before the money, it was love.
All right, guys, welcome to another Note to File live stream. Bear with me, I'm getting over being sick in multiple different ways, but very excited today to have Dr. Daniel Fox on. Dr. Fox, welcome, my man.
Hey, Brad, how's it going? Perfect, perfect song for this episode. Good taste.
I thought so. I try to, try to bring nice, relevant song choices before each episode if I can. That's like half the fun for me, right?
Oh, yeah. The creativity. I love it. And thanks for coming on. I know you're just recovering. I really appreciate you coming on today.
Yeah, nope. It's my pleasure, man. So I don't know if any of you guys read the news at all. There's been some crazy stuff lately in the industry.
Oh, yeah? My gosh. Oh, my gosh. My whole weekend was spent with heartbreak for patients who consented in a trial, for employees who busted their butts, whose work was just thrown out, for the trust that was placed in an industry that should have had a little bit more of a control over it. For years now, it's ever since COVID hit, coming from a site, seeing all of the regulations we have to go through every day, and then watching as these really deep pocket companies just keep cutting the corners, cut those corners, make it round, make some more money. Who needs this? Who needs that? It's kind of like dissecting out a really fancy car and then trying to put it back together and say, oh, we don't need this safety mechanism. We don't need that one. Why not? As long as the car can run. That's my soapbox. I was livid. And I understand the intention to have innovation and to make things better. But there is such a thing as a digression if you don't look at the history of how we've done it before. And there's no doubt in my mind, I think this is going to go in the history books. This will be a future of GCP, mark my words. It's going to be right up there with the other disasters of clinical research, the embarrassments that we as an industry have to shoulder throughout the time and the history. Sorry. So, Brad, tell me, what do you think about the news? How do you feel?
Man, it's been, making my head spin. It's like watching a slow motion car crash. I mean, not that, I don't relish any of this, but certainly, I've been critical of some of these big private equity or VC funded companies. And I think this is just the reason why. Like, I just don't think, if you've got hundreds of millions of dollars, you're under a lot of pressure to make something happen. And I don't think this is the type of industry where you can fake it till you make it. Like, you may be able to with, software or, some other product where, you can get away with it a little bit easier. Mm-hmm. So, I'm not necessarily shocked, and I'd be willing to bet, this kind of stuff's happened and is happening and we don't even know about it. But yeah, it sucks. As you mentioned, I think maybe in a post that we were talking with Ted Trafford, maybe like we're all going to feel the repercussions of this kind of stuff. And that's the biggest thing that I think is, obviously the patients are getting screwed. No question about that. I guess these were healthy subjects. I'm guessing they didn't have Lyme disease yet. So, maybe the impact isn't quite as much, but I don't know. The ramifications, I think, are going to really haven't been, well, they're not going to be seen for a while.
You've said it yourself. You have an inkling that this is just where they got caught. But now that they're going to start to peel the layers away, we're going to see far more invasive trials that have undergone the same thing, which means we may have just thrown out decades worth of progress for research. I'm waiting for the ripple effect, the tidal wave to come through. And
I sure maybe, hope not. It's been, at first I was a little bit fishy by Pfizer coming out and throwing a site network under the bus so publicly and like easily, but then I've had so many people reach out afraid to sort of say anything publicly, mm-hmm. but have talked about the problems that have gone on at Care Access. So I don't know, I still don't know. Again, like most things, the truth is probably somewhere in the middle. Certainly Pfizer has some responsibility in letting thousands and thousands of people get enrolled before they took some action, but mm-hmm. sorry, I don't want this to dominate the conversation. We're here to talk about you know, CRPN. Yes. So, man, I just want to let you sort of take the wheel here.
Absolutely.
You know, so why, what, tell us what is CRPN?
Well, so I'll go back to your song. Money ain't a thing if I ain't got it. And we as sites, we don't got it, and we should got it. No, I'm trying to be funny, but seriously, CRPN is the Clinical Research Payment Network. It was founded on the principles of just that. Sites are hurting all over the place. They are owed a lot of money. Promises are broken all of the time. And it was a site administrator who was like, I'm done. I can't do this anymore. I see this going across the industry, and I see this literally destroying our industry. If it's not going to destroy our trust among professionals, it's going to destroy supply and demand, to where we already have principal investigators who are the endangered species. You know, a bunch of 70-year-olds are still doing research now, and it's because those young guys who just got out of medical school, they can't afford to do research. So we've got to do something. We've got to change this industry. And it can't just be one guy deciding to change industry. We have to have a network. So that's essentially how the Clinical Research Payment Network started. Is it was just an organization that was designed to ensure that the sites within our network and the sites that do work with, you know, within like the in-network atmosphere, they get paid. And I mean, like, if I had my way, they do their work and the check's on the way. That's, you know, banking has done it for years. We can automate this. We can make sure that sites don't have to wait for literally years. Literally, I've posted on LinkedIn before, the anniversary of my 1 year invoice. I sent an invoice and 1 year later, I was still following up. It was like dry ice or something. I probably spent more time emailing and following up than the value of the invoice. But point is that shouldn't happen.
And yeah, I think it's, I mean, I don't know how widespread or like how well known it is, like the problem really is. And, you know, people are hearing now more sites, you know, I guess. I don't want to use the word complain because that sort of demeans it, but speak up about, you know, the issue. And, you know, I can pull up my CTMS and see, you know, you're creeping up on, you know, $500,000 in outstanding invoices. When you're a small company that's revenue driven, right? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, it's incredibly challenging to operate, you know, a business when you can't get paid. And these are some of the biggest, richest drug companies and CROs in the world. So it's completely insane to me. Well, maybe it shouldn't be. Maybe that's why they're the biggest and richest companies in the world, because, mm-hmm. you know, they don't care about, you know, paying out to the people doing the work. But
exactly.
It's just mind-boggling.
We know why they have the money. And I keep an eye on the stock prices. I like to play with investments here and there. But you look at these stock prices, it's nuts, Brad. It's nuts how much money these people have. These are the same exact culprits that don't pay their bills. Well, I guess we know why they have their money, because they break their promises. They just kind of steal. But that's CRPN. I'm going to share my screen if that's okay. Just going to show you a couple of things. Here we go. All right, so I just showed, this is just CRPN's landing page. It's www.crpaynet.com. It's growing as we speak. You'll see if you scroll down, there's Land of Lincoln Clinical Research. So there's my local site. It's on the same landing page. It has its own separate entity. You see CRPN Central. We now have a podcast going on. First one is live and the second one is it's underway. For anyone out there listening, the spoiler is episode 2 is going to be about payments. And we do have some people that we've interviewed. We've got some good community engagement about payments. It's going to be a really good conversation. The two big parties that we serve at CRPN are, of course, sites. It's very important to do the sites and work with the sites. That's our internal site network. If you join CRPN for sites, it's free. And you join this network of sites. We send out a newsletter every month. You have access to trials for free. We don't charge sites for network opportunities, for profiling, for trying to get you the work that you need. Also, there's access to the PACT report, the CRPN's own almost like a credit score for sponsors. So sites are invited to contribute to the PACT report, to contribute to the database. That access is completely free. Then we also serve sponsors. So sponsors are similar in CRPN to that of a patient who is like buying health insurance. So you buy, you pay a premium and you access an in-network health system. This health system, of course, for CRPN is the site network. So if a sponsor gets, they pay their premium, they have access to a system. There's a series of services that CRPN offers them as well, all the way from there's CDA development, there's regulatory filing, there's feasibility, again, there's networking, there's all of these different opportunities. And also sponsors now have access to the PACT S report. So it's a two-way street, right? So sites can, they can review sponsors, but sponsors also have the opportunity to review sites. So PACT has, you know, I've got scores on Brad. I've got scores on all of these other sites that sponsors are reporting to me. And so it makes for a neutral ground where it's not like CRPN is on, we're not a double agent, but it just makes it so that we can create this healthy system. I think, like you said yourself, there are sites out there that are bad apples. There's a reason why sponsors are doing what they're doing. So we have that within our network. The sponsors pay their premium, they access the network, they access predetermined negotiated rates so that sponsors with their membership card can just go in network to any one of our sites that they choose, present their membership card, and bam, they start the trial. The negotiations don't happen when a trial is on the books, which is also, it's also very key. The other thing about this system is when CRPN has an established contract with sites before a trial is even under consideration, that also means that sites are doing pre-study work under contract, which means that we don't have that crazy gap of this expected free work. No, sites do work. They do it under contract, under their master fee schedule in CRPN. Let's say you submit a feasibility or you submit a CDA or any of that work that you normally do before you sign a contract, it's covered, which means that the work that you do, you know, you get paid for it. That is part of being in the membership. The money actually, you know, it obviously comes from sponsor premiums. So sponsors are still paying you, but it's going to be, it's under a fee schedule under CRPN. So a very good gap that we successfully were able to fill. Before I go any further, Brad, did you have any questions on, or I don't see questions. Are there anyone asking questions?
I mean, can you see? You can't see any over on the right side. You don't, I don't see the comments.
Maybe I go to comments. Oh, there it is. Sorry, everyone. I was missing.
No, good. We are keeping up with your comments, guys. So definitely, if you have questions or comments, continue to, you know, jump in there. So yeah, anything that jumps out to you, feel free. I can throw it up on the screen.
There you go. So, here's a question from Claire. Go ahead. So Claire, she asks, are you always able to get invoices will be paid in 30 days in the contract? No, Claire. Well, I'll take that back. It takes pushback. You've got some of the big CROs who really try to push for quarterly payments. Some try to push for 60. Most of the time, by default, it goes quarterly and you have to correct it. And depending on the CRO, they'll either push back or they'll say, yeah, that was stupid anyway. We shouldn't have added that in.
It does seem like there's a beginning to be a little bit more, I guess, willingness for them to go to 30 days. Cause it seemed like, you know, we always ask, we always have asked, and it was kind of a mixed bag, but I feel like we've been on a pretty good roll of getting, you know, sponsors or CROs to agree to 30 day payments. So I'm hoping, I mean, look, I hope this is like a weird way to think about it maybe, but like we need to being able to turn studies away that will only pay quarterly. You know what I mean? Like if everyone just says, no, we're not going to take that anymore. We're not going to deal with that because, you know, quarterly easily turns into, you know, once or, you know, twice a year, you know, actually seeing those payments come through. Yep. Offering it. It's just madness that they still offer that as sort of a default, you know, verbiage within these CTAs.
I've actually gotten to the point where they say, oh, you know, congratulations, here's the trial, here's your contract and budget. And I said, okay, here are our site profile requirements. No quarterly payments, no windows of invoiceable opportunity. So all of the, so how many things do you just immediately strike out of every single contract you read? And the answer, there's a ton. So why not just communicate? I mean, that could even be put in the feasibility when they start to screen for you. What kind of contractual terms are we talking about here? So that when it does finally hit your eyes, it should be tailored to your needs. So that's something that you just, you're constantly doing the same thing over and over again.
I mean, are there so many sites that are just accepting terms as they are that, you know, lead sponsors and CROs to leave them in? I don't know.
It's either they accept everything or it's that whole, you know, real estate, obviously we're going to undercut you or overinflate the house because we expect you to come back. I don't know if it's like the over adjustment theory or if it's that there are really people out there who accept these kinds of provisions, which I hope so. If there are people out there who accept those kinds of things, you're a victim and there are predators that are just circling you. That's some of the things that are in these contracts and some of these CROs, is even some of the mid-sized ones, the mid-sized to large ones. They put these things in the contract and I just have to look up from the contract and think, do they really think I'm going to accept this, or who in the world would agree to this? And
please stop agreeing.
Yeah, please. Just because, and I've put that in LinkedIn too, by you accepting these junk contracts, you're making everyone's life miserable. Because if we think this is an industry standard, it's hurting our patients. It's hurting our doctors. It's hurting everyone. So we've got to get away from that predation. And CRPN is actually here to help part of that. If we can start to get the budget negotiations, if we can get all of these provisions done ahead of time and within a controlled network, like an environment where sites have they've really thought about what they need and what they want. It's not just like, here, sign this contract. You got 10 days for us to start the study. You're under a rush. You're going to make poor decisions. You've got the doctors breathing down your neck. Let's get them a really good environment where there's no pressure. They can really think about what their business needs. And then once it's established, we start. So,
one question from Ted here. I mean, what are sponsors and CROs, you know, what has their take been on these, you know, this mm-hmm. new level of transparency? Is it something that they seem to be interested in, or, you know, ultimately I would think sponsors and CROs should care about the financial mm-hmm. viability of sites because they need sites. But, you know, we haven't necessarily seen that be the case. Have you been witnessed that through, you know, putting this all together?
I've seen both. Every sponsor I talk to, once they understand what's happening, they look at that and think to themselves, wow, this is really good. I like where this is going. Not every CRO, but the CROs that, you know, remain to be silent, they look at me and say, if you put a score on this, you're going to get run out of town. We don't like this. Obviously, it's going to drop our change order rates, so we're going to be losing money. I've gotten a little bit of, you know, the spectrum across everything. Most of the progressive ones, the ones who are here for the patient, the ones who say, you know, we want better things, we're here to shoot for, like, the just-in-time people. This is like a dream come true for them. They love it. So it's mixed, Ted. It's mixed. It's here and there.
No, that makes sense. And I know this is something we're going to launch into a little bit more, but mm-hmm. Do you want to go ahead and go into a little bit about,
sure,
you know, what sorts of services you guys are providing, what sort of you know, fee structures look like?
Mm-hmm. So services provided are tiered. There's a level of consultancy services. That is because I found that every single site has a different need. Every site that I've talked to, they'll say, I need to run a gap analysis for Medicare. I need to groom my PIs. I don't know how to write a protocol. I'm pretty sure I've heard a majority of the needs of the sites. And as a result, if I don't have the expertise, I've actually, I don't know if you heard my LinkedIn post, but there's my verbal virus for the day. I've hired subcontractors. I'm part of consultants. I'm in all of these different levels where I want to make sure that site, if a site is missing something, if they realize that they need something, I want to make sure that they have access to that. Now, those services have to be paid for because I have to pay for those bills. But we want to make sure that they are competitive rates to set the sites up for success. There's a level of consultancy for sponsors as well. Sponsors do pay a premium to access the network, to have the infrastructure. However, there's a level of consultancies where we just need the sponsors to pay to fund those services. Gap analyses. I've had sponsors ask me to take a look at their protocol for clinical feasibility, not necessarily scientific feasibility. I'm sure that someone out there has read a protocol where you're thinking, this makes sense in a rat, but there's no way this would happen in a human. There's no way they'd even agree to doing these kinds of things, those kinds of services. Budget analyses for sponsors. You know, what is true fair market value? CRPN isn't going to lie to you because honestly, we're not looking to be awarded your RFP. We just want to make sure it's funded. So you're not going to get this crazy underrated RFP that would never survive a clinical environment. Those kinds of consultancy services. As far as fee structures go, the services to sites are based off of a consultancy rate. Every master networking agreement that a site signs has in the back, of course, an exhibit where if they need like a consultant service, we can set prices accordingly. We have a couple of different levels of pricing based off of site preferences. Sometimes it's buying in bulk. Sometimes it's a la carte. Sometimes it's fee for service. That there's a huge and a wide array. Sponsor fees are based off of predetermined, like a chart. Like I know exactly everything we're going to offer the sponsor. And I know how much we're going to charge. We do offer options to help sponsors who are not part of the network. Like if you don't want to pay the premium, you just want CRPN to perform a service for you. That's fine, but expect that to be a much higher rate. It's kind of like an incentive to be part of the network, going to be in there. So that's essentially the service level. The premium level is the same way. The premium is probably like a monthly rate for the sponsors to pay. And it's competitive. I have a board of advisors. I work with the advisors to understand costing according to the industry. And most of the prices that we've done compared to what a sponsor is used to paying can drop as much as 66% off of their overall cost. So 66% on 2 to 5 year study based off of everything that they're doing. And I've had it confirmed and validated across sponsor and CRO levels. So I know that it's not like an undercut RFP. It's strictly dropping duplicity and saving money for the sponsors.
What about, we spend a lot of time at sites sending along justifications and, fancy letters as we're negotiating with sponsors and CROs. Is that something you guys help or provide as part of the service as mm-hmm. well?
Part of the network. If a sponsor is asking for something like that, we can always provide that in a written form. For any of you who are out there who know me, over the past year, that I love writing. So I'd be happy to write whatever kind of letter of justification a sponsor might be asking.
Very good. I know, I wanted to take a look at the PACT score.
Yes.
A little bit, which I think is a really interesting concept that, at least put some kind of like power in the site, in the hands of the sites to, look, we can complain sort of informally. We all talk amongst ourselves, but to be able to sort of more formally grade and, just review maybe these types of CROs and sponsors and their payments. And I think it's a great idea and something that's, sorely lacking.
It's working well. If you were to go to www.crpaynet.com, and I'm sorry, Brad, but you have to make a portal. That's just how websites work. But if you were to create a portal and you were to log in, you'd have a profile and all, your standard kind of portal things. But on the CRPN website, there's an item that says PACT surveys right here. If you were to go in the PACT surveys, click on that, you're going to be taken to a landing page for PACT scores. PACT, P-A-C-T, stands for Promises, Access, Choice, and Trust, four very important variables in a site's relationship with sponsors. The PACT survey is the collection, the database of site-specific reports about sponsor activity based off of NCT number. So it is completely public information as far as the trial information goes. Any of the reported information is operational logistics, not covered under an NDA, but rather covered under the business aspects specifically to a site's experiences. The PACT score, so if you were on this landing page, you come here, PACT scores. PACT scores can be submitted only by members of CRPN. And so there are a lot of reasons for that. And it's either the site or the sponsor members. PACT scores can be submitted for every trial once every 6 months. So let's say that you submit a PACT score and sponsors are starting to feel the pinch. They want to make things better. Well, we want them to improve. So every 6 months, you can submit a PACT score for each study, and that can be validated. We make sure that that's validated. And the PACT scores do disappear. They expire from the assessment after 5 years. So once the report is 5 years old, it's dropped. So again, it gives sponsors and sites the opportunity to understand what's going wrong, understand how they are perceived, and to make the steps to change. So if you were to come into this landing page, you have two options. One is a PACT report. So again, this is kind of where CRPN helps to pay to manage PACT, is if someone wants a report, kind of like a credit report, you request a report, and you can get a report either on a sponsor site or a sponsor and CRO mix. If you were to click on this icon for your survey, it sends you to your PACT survey. You would have to submit an email address because that's how we can communicate with you appropriately. And you just go through the survey. And I thought it'd be fun if we have enough people here, if we wanted to make up a trial and let, you know, just kind of go through the survey and see if we have time, you wanted to see what this looked like.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay. It says we need to enter a link from clinicaltrials.gov, but we're just gonna one. Well, let's just say there's no CRO used on this one. So the CRO. So this is just the beginning information. You talk about just kind of general information. Now let's go into it. So P for promises. So I'm just going to let you answer these, Brad. I'm going to read them out. You say the answer.
I'm not seeing it on screen.
Let me try. Thank you for letting me know. Let me try to reping it.
Sure. Okay. Yeah, that looks right. Let me throw it back up. Boom.
Okay, there we go. So we're going to go through a PACT score. So Brad, this is your imaginary trial. Just say you can mix whatever trial. So does the sponsor make the payments on time? No, sometimes, yes, or I don't know.
Well, let's say sometimes. They sometimes do.
Okay. How on time or late? So as like 31 to 60 days late or immediately, or I don't know. You know,
I mean, I love the optimism of having 0 to 15 days early as an option on there.
You'd be surprised.
I guess it could happen. It can happen. I'd say 0 to 29 days.
Okay. Do they follow up timely with communications?
Sometimes.
Okay. How late or on time?
They're 1 to 15 days late.
Okay. Do they show up to scheduled events?
Yeah, they've always shown up to monitor visits and what have you.
How reliable is that attendance?
It's always, let's say, always reliable.
Okay. So these guys are trustworthy. You know that they're going to show up.
They show
probably up. Because the monitors get those billable hours, right?
Well, say in most cases, the monitors show up. You know, maybe they might be a little bit late, but frankly, you know. I'm usually happy when they are. It just gives me more time to not have
to. We had one. This monitor was late by 3 months because of the ice storms in Texas. I remember that one. It happens. They happen.
Yeah, sometimes not in their control.
Exactly. Does the sponsor keep the site informed about trial statuses?
Let's say no. You know, this is something I've noticed lately. Is like we've had some trials where they just haven't. They're not telling us. They don't even tell us how many patients have been screened. It blows my mind when that's the case. But Sorry, I'm gonna have like a rant for almost all of these questions.
No, that's exactly
try to keep it to myself.
No, that's exactly why we're doing this. And I love hearing it because it means that these questions resonate with you. And that was the goal. Do sponsors update, do their updates align with promised timelines?
Yeah, sometimes.
Okay. Does the sponsor uphold data entry expectations? Like, you know, we'll get that entered into the system within 24 to 48 hours or something like that.
Let's say yes. This case.
Okay. How reliable are the sponsor's data entries? Do they ever mess up any?
There's sometimes they do. They mess up on occasion. So let's say it's reliable sometimes.
Okay. Do they ensure legal agreements before requiring services, Brad?
I mean, no, almost never.
Never. Yep. That's the industry standard is no. And see, that's things like that. If we can start to measure that, that's what I want to change. I want them to say, oh crap, we better start fixing this. How frequently are services requested before legal agreements?
I mean, pretty much always.
Yep. Does the sponsor adhere to all legal agreements?
I mean,
define all, right?
I guess sometimes might be the safest answer there.
Yeah. How often does the sponsor breach legal agreements?
Yeah, I mean,
define breach.
I'd say, you know, sometimes. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know that any of them always do, but I'd say sometimes is a safe answer as well.
Has the sponsor taken GCBP? So here's your CRP and plug. I know it's in PACT, but the whole idea is I wanted GCBP to be part of PACT. So odds are, since most sponsors don't know about GCBP, the answer would be no. But it could be no, but training is in progress, or I don't know. Which one do you want, Brad?
Yeah, I'd probably just say I don't know.
I don't know about that one. Yeah, that's... and then how often does sponsor adhere to GCBP? This is a tricky question because this assumes that the person taking the survey knows about GCBP. So it's probably going to turn into another I don't know for now. Yeah. But the goal is I want people to know good clinical business practice training and what the requirements are. Also, a note on GCBP, because we're not going to delve into that tonight or today, is it is literally a curriculum built by the site network. If a site comes up to me and says, hey, you know, I think this is important for GCBP, it's modified. So it's a really good way for sites to have another voice in their industry. Nice. So I just put I don't know for now on that one.
Sure.
And there's always a blank answer. If there's something specifically about the sponsor that you are upset about, if there's like a specific detail that was not part of the survey that you really want to note, there's always an option so you can tell it. So I really want people to know that they have a voice, and this voice is taken pretty seriously because it's going to result in a difference in negotiations in the future. It could result in rates, or it could actually result in rewards, or, you know, awards being accepted or rejected because you're working with bad behaviors. So next, we did promises. Let's do access. So access is just that. Does the sponsor and or CRO provide the site with the appropriate access to the resources needed to perform their trial? So my first one, this is my big soapbox. Does the sponsor require holdback or withholding?
Yeah, I feel like it's getting better. Mm-hmm. You know, there's still some of the, it seems like it's the CROs who like to, you know, keep that holdback. Let's just say sometimes in this case.
How much do they hold back?
I mean, it seems like they always want to start with 10. Sometimes you can get them down to 5. So, mm-hmm. You know,
I actually, I was working with one, they were pushing on holdback. It was the third round of negotiations. We have to have holdback. I said, okay, I will agree to 0.25% holdback. They laughed at me, but they approved it. They had to have a holdback in their computer system. So I agreed to 0.25% holdback. Ridiculous.
Even that just seems so silly.
Does the sponsor provide timely and adequate supplies and IP?
Yeah, sometimes is probably a good answer.
Sometimes.
Generally, I'd say generally that's not a huge issue.
How long does your site have to wait for supplies or IP? Never.
Yeah, I mean, it can sometimes be weeks. I mean.
Mm-hmm. Does the sponsor offer electronic payment options?
Let's say yes. Most seem to at this point. Most.
There's some big global guys that still insist on checks, but most of the time
it's... I still have to check the mailbox.
Mm-hmm. How often do they offer it? So they offer it up, or you have to like fight for it, or
I'd say almost always that the ones that always,
Does the sponsor report, do they provide timely remittances?
No, pretty much everyone's never. It's the exception that sponsors do, unfortunately.
Yeah, unfortunately, that's just kind of how it works. What kind of remittances? So you got your lump sums. Are they fully itemized? Are they portal logged or portal walled? So you have to log into a portal just to access them.
Yeah, unfortunately, what I see more often than anything are lump sum remittance with no explanation of any kind. So literally, I have to just check my bank account and see that there's been a deposit. And if it's from, you know, PPD or MedPace, well, we may have half a dozen trials with the CRO. Mm-hmm. What's it for?
Yep.
I have no idea. That can still completely blows my mind, but sorry, again.
It's really hard to remit. It's just not very transparent at all. Do they require monitoring visits, extended data validation, or record results before payments?
Some do. It's a real weird mix, and I've been annoyed lately that I've had some that have not included that in their contracts yet. Mm-hmm. Still, that's the case. So I feel like I kind of got bait and switched on some recent contracts where, you didn't lay that out. And in fact, it almost seems like it's not laid out that way, but now you're telling me you need to monitor it before you'll pay me.
Yep.
Which then I'm the victim of when they would decide to send somebody out, you know?
Yeah. I've run into that too. And then it turned out it was a low enrolling trial and the CRO didn't want to spend the money to monitor any longer than once every 6 months. So now we're stuck with a bill, you know, like 9 months later, we get paid. It's just ridiculous. How long does your site have to wait to be paid? So monthly or less? I'll let you. So what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, oftentimes it's, around the 90-day mark, if not less than slightly more.
Yep. I found if you agree to monthly terms, odds are you're lucky to see the money in 60 days.
That's about right. Even if we're calling the crap out of them, which we've now basically like, I'm almost like trolling the sponsor, like making someone call them every single day at day 30. It's still going to be 45, 60 days. You know, it's just insane.
Because their definition is, oh, well, we process it through the computer system within 30 days of service. So the computer system needs another 15 to 20 days to process it. That's generally what they say. And it's just, it's crazy. Does the sponsor make legal agreements readily available before requesting activities? It's kind of a duplicated one.
Answer.
What is the status of the legal agreement before services are requested? So this is interesting. I've gotten to the point where they've insisted on a 1572. They've insisted on the training. They've actually shipped product to the site. And then 2 weeks later, someone from their contracts group contacts me and wants me to set up a contract or
go. Yeah, I'd say we don't usually see it go as far as IP, but you know, we definitely will get our startup packet and be like, okay, well, we want all this stuff within a few days. I'm like, cool. Where's the contract and budget? Cool. Where's the budget? Contract and budget? Oh, we don't know. There's the other team. We'll send it eventually. And I'm like, well, no, I don't. Again, why are we going to bother unless we know this is going to be even worth messing with?
Yep. And there was actually, there's a really big global company that broke budgets out by contracts and budgets. So you have three parties to work with. You have to work with a budget group, a contract. So it's just crazy. So on this one, you want to say verbal. Yeah, you know, that's cool that you're lucky if you get a verbal agreement in place. But these sponsors must be pretty accommodating. Do they require contractual terms that may result in work without pay? That's your invoiceable windows of opportunity. It's a lot of the whole things like that. So these guys, what do you want to say about that?
Yeah, let's say they do.
Yeah, they do. Okay. Among the four services being regulatory, legal, administrative, or operational, how many services does the sponsor expect to be performed without pay?
Oh, man, probably at least a couple.
Generally, I find regulatory and legal.
Those
are the big guys. Those are the ones that are always like an industry expectation. Does the sponsor require screen failure ratios?
Oh, man, that's another one. Yeah, I mean, more often than not, yes, unfortunately. Yep.
What are the sponsors' required screen failure ratios? So what are they?
Yeah, I mean, 1 to 3, sometimes more than that.
I've seen as high as 1 to 10, depending on the kind of trial.
Yeah, that's insane. So again, what an easy way to just shoot yourself in the foot if you're a sponsor. Because immediately if you hit that screen fail, you're
just not going to recruit anymore.
Yeah, you're just telling me to give up because, you know, well, again, you want me to do work for free? And we're not going to do that.
I mean, if you want to do this way, you cap screen failures. You don't give ratios. I'm not working for commission here. Sorry. Right. So 1 to 3 it's you're lucky to get 1 to 3. Does the sponsor return regulatory legal documents quickly? So do they respond back to you?
No, generally not.
No. How long does the sponsor take to return legal and regulatory documents? How long do you normally have to hear from them?
Ooh, yeah. Well, I mean, it's probably more like between the 1 to 2 week to 1 to 2 months.
Oh,
you know, oftentimes
I feel like it's like 3 weeks. I'll have to fix that. Right. Thank you, Brad.
A lot of times the holdup is on their side and not ours, you know, overwhelmingly, especially when it comes to the legal side and, you know, budget contract. We're almost always waiting on them.
And then you have an open answer. So can you give me an example of some kind of an opportunity where you were given more access than you expect and you were happy about it, or where you were denied access to something that you're like, I need this to do my job and you're not giving it to me?
Oof. I don't know if you put me on the spot here for an example.
Software is a really good one. Sometimes it's really hard to get the access to the software that you need. The ePros, I don't know how many ePros you worked on that required some kind of a customer service from some other time zone across the world, or you don't get the access or the care that you need. Sometimes, especially with IVRS and things like that, they lock it down so that you're not able to do it until you have to call in and then nobody's available. Or you have an ancillary screening that's centralized where everyone's on lunch and you're trying to recruit a patient. There's all kinds of examples of how access in clinical research is denied to sites just for trying to do their job.
Yeah, there's nothing. I mean, it happens every time. It's always when there's a patient on site ready to randomize when you need to get a hold of somebody and you absolutely cannot.
Yep. So communication, access to communication. All right, we're going to go through choice. Choice is the last set of questions and then we'll be done. So does the sponsor send open negotiation documents? There are some big CROs that send you this Excel spreadsheet that's password protected. You're not allowed to change any of the cells. You're not allowed to add anything. You have to work within their playground, even if your site does not fit within their playground. If you require different things, you have to just have a phone call with them and talk with them anyway, which means the entire template was a waste of everyone's time.
So. Yeah, no, that's a good point. So yeah, I would say we see that sometimes for sure. It seems like a mixed bag.
What types of documents? I've seen budgets and contracts both do this, which is crazy if you think about it. So both. Does the sponsor include ultimatum demands? I love doing a ratio assessment in a contract to see how many ultimatums are in a contract. You can tell the good lawyers from the bad lawyers based off of how much they want to cover the world. So if you have like, I think that's the next question, but I mean, have you seen that? Like those crazy contracts that try to literally just own the world?
Sure, sure. Yeah, I'd say it's definitely a sometimes.
How many? I'm back and forth on this. You don't have to do a complete calculation, but based off of your assessment of the contract, how many times do you see these ultimatums?
Yeah, let's say 0 to 10. So we'll say it's not too overwhelming. Not
too bad, but it sometimes happens. Does the sponsor require portal usage with logins and passwords? Right.
Always.
That's an industry standard. How many portals?
Yeah, I mean, 6 to 9, I'd say, is probably where I feel is pretty common. Yeah.
Yep. Does the sponsor mandate utilization of certain couriers or home health vendors?
I don't know that I've ever seen one that's offered like the, you know, other than this is the home health vendor. You know, I don't think I've ever seen that be an option.
Yeah. What's funny is they'll write it like a mandate. Here, go use this. and then you question them on it, and then they come back and they say, oh, well, it's totally up to you. It's totally up to you. But that's not how you presented it to us. You made it seem like a trial standard that we had to use. So it's very deceptive. So anyway, we'll go sometimes. Why not? How many couriers? Half, all, a quarter of them are mandated. Or none.
Oh, yeah, and I feel like it's mostly all of them. I feel like.
Mm-hmm. Are they willing and open to contract and budget negotiation? Or are they just like, this is the budget, take it or leave it?
Yeah, well, most are open, I think. You know, sometimes these smaller, simple registry type studies won't negotiate. But mm-hmm. I feel like most at least acknowledge the fact that there's a room for negotiation. So I'd say generally yes.
Yeah. Yes is good. How open? So are they like, sure, anything you want? Or is it like pulling teeth just to get what you need?
You know, lately I've been seeing, and I don't know, you know, how broad this is, but like they want justification for everything.
Yep.
Sometimes the most ridiculous of things.
Yep.
That I'm like, what? Like, why do we really need to justify, you know, an mm-hmm. ICF or an EKG or a blood draw or the cost of literally everything? And I can't tell if that's just a tactic to make us be like, fine, we give up.
Yep,
we'll just take what you're giving us or what, because we don't want to write a justification for 60 different line items.
I know. Hey, we ought to put a line item in our contract if they want to do that, that pays for additional work to justify. You're like, here's your justification fee. It's a lot of work. Does the sponsor require multiple trainings across numerous platforms?
Yeah, pretty much always.
It's all the time. That's the thing. How many trainings are required?
Yeah, I mean, it could well be 10 plus.
Yeah, I agree. Does the sponsor mutually schedule trial monitoring and auditing visits? Or do they just like say, hey, I'm showing up next Tuesday?
No, they're usually pretty good at the, you know, when you're dealing with like a human being that you have to see all the time, I feel mm-hmm. like it's a different dynamic, right?
Yeah.
Versus the person negotiating the budget with that you will never, ever hear from again. Mm-hmm. You know, the CRA tends to be a little more willing to play ball and develop a relationship.
There are some people that kind of just throw themselves around, but most of the time I have high respects for the CRAs we work for.
Yeah.
How many days notice do you get for a monitoring visit?
Yeah, we try to get for 2 or more weeks, but we're very flexible, but I'd say that's fair.
Okay. And can you give an example of your choice? Like what choices that you liked working with a sponsor, choices that you didn't like, you never had a choice. They just try to control everything.
It might be great. They let us use our, you know, they let us use Viva for our EREG or, you know, maybe they didn't let us use, I don't know, our eSource platform, whatever the case may be. And I haven't really seen that be the case, but again, just hypothetically.
I can't wait to see them say, we, you know, you have the choice to use MedVector and we appreciate it to help our enrollment.
There you go.
That'll be a really good one too. All right, so you just went through a PAC score, you hit submit, it's submitted, congratulations. Let's say that you do this and the PAC score database is building up. We have sites from across the country throughout the network who are contributing to put their voices online. And then let's say that someone comes up, let's say a site comes up and says, hey, you know, we've got this trial opportunity with the sponsor. We kind of want to get a background check on the sponsor, want to figure out what's going on. So what we end up doing is, I think I'm going to have to reshare, but I will show you an example of a PACT report. So that's what a survey looked like. But then if we go to the PACT report, all of the questions that you asked about, and it's not here. Why isn't it here? Let me pull it up.
It's okay. In the meantime, I'm going to throw up here. I love Jade idea of like doing a monthly live webinar with like a site and a sponsor. And, you know, even like, I think it'd be cool to do like live PACT scoring. Maybe that's a little too, you know, maybe that's a little too transparent. I mean, I'm all for transparency, like probably more than most, but I don't know how well that would go over with a lot of folks, but you know, again,
I think that kind
of information would be huge for both sides, really. Mm-hmm. And I don't know about you. When I talked at Magi back in November, it was really interesting to me because I did sort of a debate with a CRO contact about, you know, hidden site costs, and there were sponsors mm-hmm. in the crowd. And it was really interesting to me to sort of learn that there's also a big disconnect between the sponsor and the CRO. That the sponsor sometimes doesn't seem to know mm-hmm. what the CRO is doing.
I'm finding that too.
And sites are basically like, you know, I'm like, hey, screw this sponsor, when it's not really the sponsor's fault at all. It's the CRO's fault. No. But the sponsor is sort of getting the bad name because of the way that the CRO is handling the process. So I think mm-hmm. I found that really interesting, maybe something that didn't immediately occur to me.
Yeah, I've especially since I've started talking with sponsors more and more, the veils are starting to get pulled out. And what I'm finding is sites and sponsors have the same frustrations. They really do. And it's because they're not connected with each other. There's this really weird break in communication when sites are dependent on CROs for sponsor contact and vice versa. There are things that were never communicated to either party through the middle person. It's just crazy.
Yeah, it's like a bad game of telephone.
So after the industry collection, the database comes through, we have a number of entries now. The sites are submitting for sponsors at a much faster rate than sponsors are submitting to sites right now. But I do expect that to pick up. You come through and you say, I want a pack report. Pack report, I put it into three different levels based off of the data that we're put into there. There's the lowest level is literally just, you'll get like lows and highs. Lows, middle, high, you kind of give you a general idea. And then the second level has the actual scores in them that you'll see the scores in a minute. But here I'm showing pack max. So pack max shows your highs, lows, your percentages, your percentiles, and even some discrete data at the bottom, like, hey, watch out for remittances on this sponsor, or, you know, these guys always bait and switch, or they never let me do an amendment whenever I need it, or something like that. The exact details, the nitty gritty of the experience working with these sponsors. That's what goes in the pack max. So I figured out this one shows all of the options. So we'll go from here. One thing to note on here is this is a compilation of data. Be sure to use it at your own risk. You know, CRPN does not take responsibility for how you make your decisions based off of this. We're only reporting the information. That's, you know, don't come back at me saying, you know, that you were wrong or you lied. No, this is based solely off of community engagement and entry. So the first page is just your information. This is just an example. So we put this here, but this would be where you'd have the information of the person who requested it, your NCT number, all of the information about the sponsor. Here's a legend. It's just basically the low, middle, high is broken into thirds. You can normalize that based off of occurrence and bell curves, but for now, we're just keeping it simple with thirds. You're going to see industry average. So we do put into here an assessment of the entire database and a comparison. So you can see kind of where this lies in the industry. For example, Brad, like you said, everyone requires an insane amount of portals, and everyone will generally ask sites to do work for free. That's just the industry standard. It's the expectation. If you're in this industry, that's what you have to do. So your industry average will obviously be lower on those sections. You've got the CRPN average. And here's the theory. If everyone is accountable, we're all going to be doing better. So odds are your CRPN average is going to be higher than that of the industry average because the standards are a little higher. And then finally, you've got a score. So as you go down here, the PACT that we had is broken into even like subcategories where promises go into adherence and accountability or responsiveness and communication, cooperation and collaboration. And it's essentially an assessment of all of those answers that you made broken down into a communication of the database versus where you lie in the industry. So in this certain example, it was medium, high, medium. So they did okay. They're within the 50th to 60th percentiles. But overall, their score is a little lower for adherence and accountability for the industry. They're pretty good at responding. They're better than the average bear, but they're not great at cooperating or collaborating. They're kind of ruffled. This is the analysis you would get. So you'd be like, okay, you know, I know kind of what to expect when I work with these people. Access to financial supplies and resources and legal regulatory same thing. You'd be able to compare your score versus your industry average. Choice is professional, legal, financial, and vendors. So this is like the site's ability to make choices throughout here. And you'd be able to see how the sponsor rates in the industry. And then finally, trust. Trust, are they dependable? Do they have good time and resource management, or do they have good professional conduct? And you can compare it across the industry on if they're really good. Now, once you start comparing, you can start saying, wow, you know, look, I'm one of the best. I have one of the best PAC scores in the industry. And that is a discrete number that you as a site or you as a sponsor could say in the industry, saying, look, my PAC score is this. I am really good to work with. People like working with me. They trust me. And I pride myself in that. So it gives you something to focus on besides the bad. And then you go to overall ranges. So this is you're pooled back into your PACT and where you lie in the industry. And then finally, here's the big bad score. So in this certain example, the trial had a score of 127, which is 46th percentile. The sponsor had 199, which is 73rd percentile. So it's not bad. And then the CRO had a 185, which is the 68th percentile. So you're like, okay, you know, this, at least I know kind of where we are in the average and where these guys lie. And then finally at the bottom, you'd have comments on the sponsor, the CRO, and overall in this example. So in this one in particular, I think the sponsor is well known. It's a really big sponsor. They work with a really big CRO. And as a result, they are reliable because they're big. You're going to get your money eventually. They're stable. They do value their partnership, and that's their characteristics. But you also got to watch out because they don't communicate very well because there's 50 departments that have to go working on there. There's convoluted processes, and they're disconnected. So that's kind of what you got to watch out for. Same thing with the CRO. It's big. It's global. It's fragmented. They have late payments, but you can't avoid them because they're huge in the industry and everyone uses them. So just got to be honest with them. And then finally, here's an overall based off of the fact that these are two global organizations. Expect some longer wait times, but also expect that they do have some systems in place to get the job done. So overall, that is kind of what you would see in a PACT report. And I'm going to stop because I see questions. So I'm going to stop sharing and we'll talk about questions.
Yeah, no, I mean, I love that. I think as a site, you know, sometimes, especially now, I've noticed like we're working with a lot of newer, seemingly newer sponsors. Some of them aren't using a CRO. So, you know, if there's anything historically, you know, we can learn before, you know, getting too deep, because I mean, of course, there's a lot of great promises up front. They're all, everything's good and great. You're going to get paid. And, you know, 3 months, 4 months, 5 months, we've enrolled 45 patients in a trial. We were supposed to be paid monthly. And that first patient was in September of last year. We've not received a dime yet.
Oh my gosh.
You know, that's a real thing we're dealing with as we speak.
So you know, you're harping on them saying, where's my money? No more recruitment. I mean, you're doing everything you can to.
Well, yeah, I think that, you know this too. It's tough when, you know, the PI is like, it's hard to tell the PI, like, this is a trial that's very much driven by the PI. So I don't be like, oh, hey, we're going to stop because we're not being paid. While he is supportive, he still doesn't want to stop enrollment. So it puts us in like a weird situation where we're busting our asses. We're not getting paid, but the doctor is not necessarily going to stop either. And we're not going to tell the doctor to stop because that's going to hurt our relationship with our doctor. So, you know, instead we're sitting on $500,000 where you owe us, you know, what are you doing? And maybe that's something that could have been known about, if there was a PACT score I could go to, you know, so I love that
ability. And you're invited to submit a PACT score. I hope that you do. We really, and it's not just the squeaky wheels. I mean, I would really like for the sites in CRP and network to make PACT score entry a standard. Just mark your calendar. Okay, I'm doing this every 6 months, because I don't want it to be so negatively driven. Like, you know, oh, you know, I don't like the sponsor, so I'm submitting a PAC score. And then all of a sudden, all the scores are like in the tank because we don't get the good ones.
Fair. And I think it is important to recognize the sponsors and CROs that are doing it well. You know, we've had some pay us our startup fees within days after an SIB without us even invoicing. I mean, those people need to get their props, yeah. you know, because yeah. I think that's huge that, you know, some companies do that sort of stuff. So any questions you want to address, feel free to call out. I'll throw them up and we kind of start winding on down here.
Mm-hmm. I saw how many sites, the answer, we're in the 20s now. How many sites are in the CRP network? We're in over 20 sites now. We have sites across every time zone, and actually we have some international sites. We have some sites in the UK and in Colombia.
And I feel like this is the kind of thing, obviously, that, you know, as becomes more powerful as it scales, right? Because, I mean, you've got more data from more sites. It just becomes that much more powerful as more sites to have more studies get there, and you've got more data to play with. I mean, I love this concept, and, you know, I'll definitely be submitting plenty of PACT scores.
Yeah. So, you know, Brad, I think it's safe to say that you're part of CRPN. You're in the network.
Sure.
And so as a result, Brad has access to full PACT scores. He has access to network opportunities, although I'm not sure what I can send him that he doesn't already have. He's pretty well established, but point is he's got access to this. He's got access to not opportunities, and he hasn't paid CRPN anything. We don't ask for money from him because he's not requesting services. So these are free services to him to help his practice, to help his site grow.
Well, I think to your point about having some sort of like a la carte, you know, services, I mean, every site's so different in their needs. So I really feel like any successful provider that is sort of servicing sites need to recognize that. I mean, no two sites are the same. Almost none have the same needs, you know, so to really be able to cater, you really do have to be able to, you know, offer, again, sort of like a la carte service. So I really love that, because otherwise, if it's all or nothing, I mean, most sites are going to say no, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Most sites, they're going to say, nope, I'm good on negotiating. I don't need it. But then right. they, in the same breath, they said, oh, but I can't find a PI. I have the physicians, they want to be investigators, but I just, you know, I don't know how to get them going. Or, you know, I'm in an oncology center and I need a gap analysis and I don't know how to do it. Do you have someone who can help you with that? There's literally every single site has a different need. So we have to be able to tailor to their needs just by offering a la carte services.
Yeah. Agreed. Mm-hmm. All right, man. Dr. Fox, anything else before we wrap up here? Anything you see?
I appreciate it. If you want to learn more about CRPN, www.crpaynet.com. You're welcome to reach out to me and help us to grow this network.
Yeah, I really appreciate everybody dialing in, asking questions. You know, we have a good following going on LinkedIn. If you're feeling generous today, go subscribe on YouTube, where I have a very embarrassing 30 subscribers. So you know, we do these live streams weekly now, and really just trying to continue to bring all the different voices to you know, the industry here. So. Again, appreciate you guys. Thanks, Dr. Fox. And I'm sure we'll continue crossing paths on LinkedIn, man.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Brad.
Thanks, guys.
Bye.